I guess the really pivotal moment was here in Austin when I was a senior in high school. But I walked into Straight Music one day and there was an upright in there, and I put my hand on it and played one note and went. One note did it for me. Really, it's like, that sound? I can make that sound? Done. Well, I was born in Poughkeepsie, New York. My dad was a New Yorker, my mom was a Texan. So my youth was divided between New York and Texas. Well, I have an older brother whose name is Tom, and he was probably my primary musical influence just through his record collection. My first guitar was like an $18 acoustic, blonde acoustic guitar. But when the British invasion happened, it was kind of all over. It was like, I want an electric guitar. And we ended up buying a Les Paul Jr., a late 50s Les Paul Jr. and a Silvertone amp for $80, I think. I decided that my brother, being such a music fan, should play. And so I taught him guitar, which I was playing, and then I said, well, you know, one of us ought to play bass. So at 14, I went downtown Poughkeepsie and bought myself a Japanese hollow body bass for $100. And that was the beginning of my life in bass. Couple of reasons I ended up on bass. One being when I was in these groups when I was 11 years old and stuff, I was always the smallest guy. I'd be 11, the other guys would be 15, 16. And sooner or later they get tired of me and toss me out of the band. And you know, bands in those days, like, you'd have three guitar players and somebody tune a guitar down or something. So I thought, you know, if I had a bass, they wouldn't kick me out if I had a bass. For 14 years before Mom won, and we moved to East Texas, to Atlanta, Texas. And at 14 years old, I considered it purgatory, basically. And what I kept hearing was Austin, Austin. Austin's where you gotta go. Austin's where the music is. And so at 17, my senior year of high school, I finally made it here to Austin. Austin was a happening place in the mid-70s, really a very happening thing. I mean, I went to Antone's and heard Kim and Jimmy Vaughn, and I went to the Sun Theater and heard the Electromagnets, met Eric. James Polk. We went to hear James with his organ trio over on the east side. It was called the Royal Lounge. It was on East 11th. And the moment we pulled up, we could pull up and park right in front of the Royal Lounge, just right in front of it. And the moment we pulled up there, I felt something. It was going. And it was the bottom end of that B3 organ, you know. It was doing all this other stuff, of course, but it was just the bottom carrying right out into the parking lot. And again, it was like, well, no, that's the coolest sound ever. I got a job dispatching taxi. Probably the last job I ever had. And it lasted a couple of days. But I was dispatching taxi, and Fred Walter walked in one day and he said, hey, I've got a gig for you with James Polk Sunday on the east side. Afterwards, James said, you know, I don't like to play with bass players as a rule. He said, but I like your playing. He said, I like your lines. And I said, you should. I said, they all came from you. And so we formed a band around him, myself and several of the members of the UT Jazz Ensemble at the time. We formed a band around James and called it James Polk and Company, which worked fine for a couple of years until Ray Charles asked James to come play with him. But we had two keyboard players. We had James and Bill Ginn, so we were able to sustain the loss, but we did have to change our name since James is called James Polk and Company. So at that point, it became Passenger. As fabulous as Austin was in the mid-70s, I was hearing a call to leave at the same time. So there was great music happening here, and people knew there were great music happening here, but you had to take it out of here to get it recognized. Take it to Europe, or take it to LA, or take it to New York, or take it to Nashville, but take it somewhere where there's a record company. Through chance and fate, perhaps, a cassette tape of Passenger got into the hands of a man named Henry Louis, who was a record producer in Los Angeles, best known for his work with Joni Mitchell. And one day here in Austin, Texas, my phone rang, and a man with a German accent, hello, Roscoe, I have your tape here. And I like this very much. Would you be interested in playing with Joni Mitchell? So I was like, yeah, my two shirts are packed. Let's go. But Henry was producing Joni, but he was also midway through producing a Leonard Cohen record. So one morning he called and said, I need a bass player for Leonard Cohen. And he just asked for the bass, but I brought along Bill Ginn and Steve Metter as well. And shortly, you know, Leonard pulled out a nylon string guitar and said, okay, here's a song. Played it for me. And Henry said, okay, well, let's record. Plugged in a Fender bass, and Leonard and I recorded this song. At some point, I think I suggested we could maybe use some time, so we got Steve Metter to play brushes on a Ampex tape box. And that went on the record, pretty much like that. Bass, guitar, and Ampex tape box. So it went well, and Leonard said, I said, well, that was great. Let's do that again sometime. And Henry said, well, he has a whole band, you know. And Leonard said, well, next time bring them all, which is what happened. So another session was scheduled with Passenger, and we ended up finishing the record, which ended up being called Recent Songs in 1979. And at the end of the record, Leonard invited us out for margaritas at a place called El Compadre. And we're having our margaritas, and he invited us to do a European tour that fall. And so that was the beginning of a relationship in 1979 that lasted right up through his last live date. What Austin was able to do in the 70s was give you a cheap place to live. And lots of clubs to play in. And a fella could make a decent living playing clubs in the 70s. I know, because I did. It's not as easy these days. I feel like Austin has a lot more going on right now even than I know about. There's so much talent here, always has been, and still is, and maybe more. So there's still people making great music here in Austin, and I'm always really pleased and excited when I hear somebody new. It reignites me and reinvigorates me. Thank you. I do get asked every now and then for advice, and it's always pretty much the same answer, which is don't quit. You have to be committed to it for the long haul. As a musician, and I'm sure as a band, there's lots of ups and downs. There's lots of bumps in the road. And you got to ride them all, you know. And there's feast and there's famine. And I've tasted a lot of both. Not as much feast as one might like, but it has happened, you know. And you do get through the famine, too. They are both part of the deal. Stick with it, you know. It's worth it. It's worth it. Just hang in there. Just don't stop. If that's your dream, if that's what you gotta do, if somebody comes up to me and they go, you know, I want to play bass. I want to do what you do. I want to join a band. I want to be on stage. And I'll just say, can you imagine doing anything else? Can you imagine doing anything else? And if the answer is no, I can't imagine doing anything else, then do that. Do that. Stick with it.